Hello. First of all, before we get started, I would like to address, I got a question, how far should we have come in the course right now? And I mean, this is the first lecture where we start using JavaScript in the way that you are supposed to do in the second assignment and in the exercises. So I don't expect anyone to even have started with exercises yet. So I would say that this week it's a good thing if you get started with the exercise repository, and maybe tomorrow or on Friday could start with the first couple of exercises. So that's mainly it, and you can start working on the assignment during later part of next week. We have a problem though with the exercises and the assignment that I didn't see, and that is there are README files in your exercise and assignment repo on our organizations. The ones you are supposed to use for exercises, you could do whatever you like, but for the assignment, you should work with the repo you get from our organization in the same way that you did with the first assignment. But the problem is that in those repos there is a README file, and this README file will cause a merge conflict with the exercise repo or the assignment repo that you will pull into that repository, and you will get a merge conflict. So I will tomorrow afternoon record how an additional recording to the one I already did, where I will show how to resolve this problem. Because all the repos are already created. Otherwise, we could have changed this, but now they are all created, so I will have to do a fix. But there will be a recording tomorrow about that. So today I will start speaking about all the stuff that are going on with the exercises. Why do we have this vagrant machine, and what's happening inside of that? And how shall we work in the course with the client-side JavaScript? So this is actually those are lectures I had last year, and they were like too long. So I will have a little higher tempo this year than last year. There are recordings in Swedish for those lectures as well, if you like, that are already up on the course webpage, but I will do them in English for you. Yeah, I think that's pretty much it. So let's get started with the right presentation, this one. So before lunch, we will have a look at the browser and what is going on in the browser. How is JavaScript executed and where, and how should we link our JavaScripts like into the page, and how do we make JavaScript communicate with the HTML. We will have a look at some developer tools in the browser, and we will also have a look at the build process with Browserify that I will touch upon in the end, and this is why we are using the Vagrant machines as well. So let's get started. This is a quote from Crockford from his series The JavaScript Programming Language. I think we have linked some of his lectures. They are getting old, so they are not that up to date anymore with the new ECMAScript 2015, but they are pretty good to have a look at anyway. And he says this: the browser is a really hostile programming environment, and you will notice that because if you're programming Java, you have like the Java virtual machine, and you have a version of the Java virtual machine that basically everybody's using. So in the browser, it's different. We have a standard saying that, okay, browsers should comply with this and this and this and this, but all the browsers are different in some ways. Some don't support all the APIs. Some support other APIs, and in the worst case, they support the APIs, but in a falsy way or in a wrong way. They have interpreted the standard slightly different than anybody else. This was a problem for 10 years ago, this was a really big problem for web developers because the browser environment was so vastly different. Today, the standards are better written, so misunderstandings should not happen. And all the browser manufacturers are working towards the same goal, to make the web a good platform. So, being a web developer today, it's easier when it comes to standards and working with the browser. It might be harder in another way because we have a lot of more tools, we have a lot more APIs, we have a lot more choices to make. But often those choices are at least working in most of the browsers. So remember this, that when you are in the browser, you're in like enemy territory, because I mean, first of all, the browser is at the user, so your code will be running in the user's computer and interpreted in the user's computer, and the user has full insight of your code. The user can change your code to make it run in another way. And when it comes to security, we must really know that. And we have this, I mean, different, not only different browsers, but we have different units like mobile phones, watches, regular computers and stuff. And your applications are supposed to maybe work in all of those environments. I've shown this before, I won't dwell on it anymore for you, but we have the server and we have the client, and now we will still focus on the client side of stuff. So the code we will write will be running in the client. Last lectures, when I showed JavaScript, just the language JavaScript, you can run that pretty much wherever you like. You can run it in the server, you can run it in the browser, you can run it in applications that support JavaScript. So you can script stuff. But today we will focus, and now on, we will focus on the client. In the next course, for you who will take that one, we will focus on the server instead and the Node.js. But today we will focus on the browser. And that also means that we will leave Node. Actually, the examples I did last week were executed in Node. So that's why I recommend you to install Node, to have it as an experimental platform if you like. But in the Vagrant machine, we will have Node installed, and Node will probably be used for some server stuff that you don't need to worry about, because that will be under the hood. So we will focus 100% on the client. Yay! Do I not have a network connection? Well, there it is. So, first of all, browsers. I think I did some kind of poll with you, what browsers you were using. I think it looked something like the majority of this chart. So I took those numbers yesterday, and it's from the gsstatcounter.com. It's always hard to get accurate usage out of web browsers because it depends on how you measure. But this is some kind of near the truth, I guess. So we can see that Chrome is by far the most popular browser today. This is vastly different from 10 years ago, where other browsers like Firefox and Internet Explorer was the big browsers. But Google has done a really good job in getting market shares in the browser community. It's actually higher worldwide than in Sweden. I guess this comes down to Safari being quite popular in Sweden, and that, I think, comes down to that people in Sweden tend to use iPhones in a broader extent than the rest of the world. And if you have an iPhone, you might likely use Safari on your desktop computer as well. So the numbers in parentheses, they are mobile users, and the other ones are laptop users or computer users. I think it's mobile and iPads and stuff as well. So we won't. I just want to to show you this one so that you have some kind of pictures of what browsers you are expected to support if you write web applications. Those are basically the ones. But more interestingly, we will have a look later on which rendering engines and JavaScript engines are run in those browsers. So you can make a choice if, oh, do I really need to test everything in Chrome and Opera? Or is it just okay to test stuff in Chrome, for instance? So, compatibility, because, okay, we have this, this is the world we live in with different browsers, and if you write applications, you need to support them. So, how will we do it in the course? Sorry, you're on your own. I will not, in this course, like say that, okay, so this function works in Internet Explorer 8 and 9, and this only in Internet Explorer 7 and higher, and I've basically tried to do that 10 years ago when I started those courses, and it's a hazard to just always being up to date with which browsers support which APIs in which way. So you are on your own. For the course sake, as long as it runs in something that is not like the nightly build of something, it's okay. So if it writes in the latest version of Chrome, for instance, perfectly fine. If it runs in the latest version of Firefox, perfectly fine. Just stay away from the nightly builds, but other than that, you're fine for the course. But I want to point, if you are going to work in this field, you need to have a good understanding of which APIs will work in which browsers. And I mean, the big problem is a problem going away, and that is Internet Explorer. Internet Explorer traditionally have had a lot of problems following standards and implementing the latest APIs. But with Edge, Microsoft has more or less gotten to the exact same level as Chrome and Firefox and the other browsers. Now I would probably say that the big problem is Safari, because Apple are sometimes a bit slow on implementing the latest APIs. So I would say that Edge and Chrome and Firefox, those are pretty much up to date with most of the things, and Safari sometimes are lacking support for different stuff. So how will you know what to use? I've shown it before. I showed can I use before when we looked at HTML and CSS. So you can use can I use for JavaScript as well. So can we use WebSockets, for instance? WebSockets, yeah, looks pretty good actually. It even works in IE, so this should be fine today. And I forgot the other one I should try. Yep. So if you want to try out the new payment request API, which seems fairly new, I think this is a Google initiative to have a payment API for the browser, then you will have some kind of problem, right? Because none of the major browsers, with the exception for Chrome for Android, are supporting this API at the moment. So this is a good page just to have a look at what to support and not. Of course, you can use the developer.mozilla.org, the usual documentation that we have talked about, if you like, you will find some kind of browser compatibility charts in the documentation as well. So, but for this course, please try out new stuff and just be aware that it might not work in every browser. Maybe I should turn the lights down a bit. Okay, so browser components. We will have a look at the browser. Like that, I think. And the browser is made up of several parts. We have the user interface, like buttons and the address fields and stuff. We have the browser and rendering engine. That is an essential part for this type of course. This is where the parsing of the HTML is going on. So you send the browser some HTML, and the parser will go in, try to correct it if you've written it in a wrong way, and then it will lay out and render this page and add the CSS styles, for instance. So this is a major part of the browser when it comes to HTML and CSS. Then we have the JavaScript engine, and the JavaScript engine is, of course, a key component when we talk about JavaScript in the browser. And this is where, in the JavaScript engine, a lot of optimization has been done the last 10 years, and especially the last like 6 or 7 years, where all the browser manufacturers has put in a lot of effort to make JavaScript running super fast in the browser. Is it fast? Well, depends. I mean, JavaScript is an interpreted language in its foundation, so it will be interpreted. Hard word. Interpreted. I would say it quickly, so no one will hear that I'm pronouncing it wrong. So, but JavaScript is interpreted from the top to the bottom, and as it runs. But that's not true anymore, because the JavaScript engines will have a look at the code and try to optimize the code in different ways. And one optimization is that it will actually try to compile stuff in your or blocks in your code that could be compiled, so that when the code runs, some parts of the JavaScript code will be run compiled. And there is a talk in, I have a link on the course webpage to a talk at Nordic.js last year. And in the talk, I don't remember her name. Whoa, I think she's from Germany. She talked about optimization of the JavaScript engines, and she compared JavaScript to C++, native C++. So she wrote an algorithm for finding the first 2,500 prime numbers or something like this, or the 25,000 first prime numbers, something like that. Essentially, an algorithm that calculated prime numbers. And she ran tests on the performance. And JavaScript was just behind C++. And that's not what when you think about JavaScript, you don't think of JavaScript as being a language where you can do super fast calculations. But actually, today, in the modern engines, you can, because there is a lot of optimization going on. So it's not as simple as saying that JavaScript is an interpreted language. It's actually more complicated than that. But have a look at the talk. It's really interesting. It's like half an hour or something like that. And you will, I think you will get an understanding of the complexity of the JavaScript engine. It happened a lot the last years. And that's a year old as well. So maybe, I don't think JavaScript would be faster than C++, because it's somewhere in the background. It's C++ code running anyway in the browser, or in Node, I guess. Or if it's C, I'm not sure. But it's quite fast anyway. And often, I mean, what we do in the browser is often not that type of calculations. It's other stuff we're doing. The most demanding things is probably writing games. So that's where a lot of increased performance is preferred. So moving on, network layer, this is, yep. Does it try to correct JavaScript as it does? Do the browser try to correct the JavaScript in the same way as it does with the HTML? No, not really. But JavaScript, the language JavaScript, has some quirks built in that it will correct, like the semicolons, for instance. If you omit the semicolon in the end of a line, the JavaScript engine will add it for you. So there are some kind of corrections that will be done. But, and of course, then it will optimize it in some way. So it might even rewrite some stuff just to make it faster. but not to the extent where you can almost write falsy code and it will correct the code for you like it is in HTML. You will get an error if you write falsy code, basically. The network layer, it handles requests and responses, and this is quite important when it comes to techniques like AJAX and WebSockets. We will have a look at the network layer later on. We also have data persistence in the browser using SQL databases, using an API called Web Storage, and Web Storage is a simple key value storage in the browser. We will have a look at that as well, and we have the cache. If we go back in time, we had a cache and the cookies, basically. And cookies is those small text files that are stored in the user's browser environment and sent to the server for every request to that server. And that's because the server needs to know who is requesting what. So if you're logged into a page, for instance, the server needs to know that you are you. And this was usually done by cookies and is actually still in a large extent. But cookies been around forever. Web storage is newer and it's suitable for caching stuff in applications. Like if you make a music application, you probably would like to cache playlists and stuff. So you don't need to read them from the server every time the user boots up your application. So you could use web storage for that. The cache is, like we've talked about, caching JavaScript, caching CSS, caching images, for instance. So that's built into the browser. We can manipulate the cache and work with the cache. We won't look at that too much in this course, I think. Maybe I have a slide or two about it in the end of the course, maybe. Okay, looking at the graphical representation of this is from a conference paper. It's really hard to find good visual images of how the browsers are built. This one has been around since 2005, and I think it's still a okay representation to just have something to fall back on when you think about those the browser engines and JavaScript engines. And it's pretty much like this. I would maybe argue that some of the arrows should be in both directions, for instance, but this is pretty much it. The user interface is what the user sees, and the browser engine. And this is basically depending on who you ask, you will get different answers. Sometimes the browser and rendering engine is just put together in a big bag and called the browser engine. Sometimes it's called the rendering engine altogether. But I would say that it's, like in this article, is two separate things. The browser engine responsible for parsing the HTML and adding the CSS, and the rendering engine is responsible for rendering it and telling the UI how to paint the web page, basically. But it's okay if you see it as one. Just call this the browser engine that handles HTML and CSS, it's okay. And then we have the JavaScript engine as a separate part in the browser. The networking layer is a separate part. And the data persistence is on the edge, just as a separate part as well. And when we look at different browsers, we will see that some of them, for instance, share the same network networking parts in the browser, and some engines share the same JavaScript engine. Some browsers share the same browser engine. So that is when it becomes really important to just to know that those things exist in the browser. I will skip that one. Actually, there is a link. This is Douglas Crockford's representation of all of this. He has a talk about it. So please look at it if you're interested. So back to the browsers. This is a chart of how it looks today. How many of you will connect Chrome to WebKit? None? Doesn't say in the chart, so no. But a couple of years ago, Chrome used WebKit. So Google and Apple had the same browser engine. However, I think it's like 2 or 3 years ago, Google said enough, basically, because Apple wanted to have a lot of backwards compatibility in their browser, in Safari. And that made, in Google thought that that made WebKit really slow. So they forked WebKit and made their own version called Blink. And in that process, I think like they removed somewhere between 1,000 and 2,000 of files and like a million lines of code just put in the trash because they didn't need it anymore. So now on, WebKit or Safari and Google are separating the rendering engines. However, in the same process, Opera, who had their own engine before, they said that, okay, we will go with this new one, Blink, called Blink. So today, Opera and Chrome are using the same rendering engine, they are using the same JavaScript engine, and they are using the same network layer as well. So I would say that if you get stuff to work in Chrome, you will probably get them to work just as well in Opera because they are sharing so much under the hood. So the big difference is UI stuff and other stuff around the browser and JavaScript engines. That doesn't mean that you don't need to test in Opera, but you don't need to test as extensively in Opera, I would say. Internet Explorer is using a browser engine called Trident and a JavaScript engine Chakra. This one was called JScript in the beginning, and with like IE8 or something, they changed the name to Chakra and rebuilt it because the JScript engine wasn't a lot of fun, to say the least. Firefox is using Gecko, and Gecko as browser engine it's been around for quite a long while, since Netscape, I think. And if you have a look, when you visit the page with a browser, the browser will tell the server some information like, okay, I'm a Windows computer running this browser and stuff. It sends a header to the server. And if you look at an Internet Explorer communicating with the server, this will actually say that it's running Gecko. So why is that? Because Microsoft have never been running Gecko. Yeah, that's because if we go back to the browser wars, when developers said that, okay, my site is optimized for Netscape. So I write an if statement like, if browser is Gecko, then it's okay, else go away. And when Microsoft implemented functions that were in Netscape, but Microsoft was still shut out of those pages, even if they supported them. Then they said, okay, we could call ourselves Gecko. So they added Gecko to their header. So when they visited those sites, they will also be let in because they are kind of a Gecko. And that lives on. And so still today, if you look at modern versions of IE, you will see this Gecko keyword in the header. I don't think it's in Edge, because those types of sites that just look at browser engines, you should never write code like that today. Today we use something called feature detection instead that basically says that, okay, do you support this feature or not? If you don't, okay, then we try to replicate this behavior. Otherwise, we let you in with running this feature instead. How does the rendering engine affect your code? It basically won't, because they are all implementing the same API. If we look at the browser engine, they are all using the API called the DOM. And the DOM API is pretty much today standardized, and everybody is using it the same way. However, when it comes to JavaScript, there will be differences. Quite big differences when it comes to language support, for instance. If you like the arrow functions I showed you yesterday, you can't use them in Nitro because Nitro hasn't implemented them yet. It will in the next version of Safari, but they are not there in this version. So it's, I mean, if it works, if arrow function works in Chrome, it will work in Opera. But it's not sure that it will work in the other engines. So this is, once again, something you need to look up. Okay, is it okay to use let when I declare variables? So do I need to use var, for instance? A lot of stuff like that that you need to take in consideration, but not for this course. So in this course, I would recommend the first line, but you are free to use anyone if you like. And why I recommend it is because we have the V8 engine, and the V8 engine is the one Node is using as well. So Node is using the V8 engine, and Chrome and Opera is using the V8 engine. It's, I mean, there will be, and when Microsoft will or Apple will release their new browser, they will say this is the fastest browser ever, and we are beating V8 by this much. And the next month there will be a press release from Google saying we are the fastest browser, because they are like competing all the time. And it depends on how you measure stuff and which optimizations are being done in the different browsers. So this is a constant, ongoing war. But the war today is a healthy war. It's a war for that benefits all. The wars that we had in the 90s were like not that good for the web. So I think it. I mean, the versatility in this comes with a price that you as developers need to make choices sometimes. But the good thing is that this takes us forward, because they are competing. They are not like sitting back and saying everything is fine. They need to compete to be at the top all the time. So that makes JavaScript run faster and faster for every week, more or less. Because everybody wants web pages and web applications that render faster, because that makes their units, like iPhone, for instance, that makes the unit snappier than if they had a slow browser. Okay, enough about that. Why JavaScript in the browser? Okay, because of reason. I mean, it could just as well have been Java, because Java had the upper hand. When the web was developed in the 90s, Java were supposed to be the language that we will write our web applications in. Basically, Java was supposed to be the language that everything should be run in, like everything from a soda machine to the web applications, to desktop applications, to automobiles, whatever. Java should be the language. However, so Java was in the browser, was called Java Applets. It's possible you can run Java Applets in the browser still, but I wouldn't recommend it. But Netscape, they found out that Java was quite hard to run in the browser. It wasn't like built to integrate to a great extent with the browser and with HTML and with later on CSS. So Netscape started to develop. They gave Brendan Eich the task of developing a new language that they could use in their browser. And as I said last time, he developed JavaScript in 10 days, and it was more or less Scheme. He liked the functional way of programming. But the executives said that Java is a thing. We need Java. This doesn't look like Java. We need Java in the browser. So he adapted the syntax from Java, and the name as well. So JavaScript, it was called LiveScript from the beginning, but now it's JavaScript. And since then, we've been stuck with JavaScript. Microsoft tried to do their own language, VBScript, Visual Basic Script. It failed as well. In the late 90s, it was used somewhat, but today it's gone. So today, the only browser language we have, basically, is JavaScript. Google is trying to find a better language, and they are doing it by Dart. That is another alternative, maybe, in the long run. But today we're stuck, if you like, with JavaScript. So what do we do use JavaScript for? Yeah, pretty much anything you can do in the browser that it's not just looking at a static web page like those you did in the first assignment. So applications and games, you could run pretty good games in the browser today. you can do quite advanced rendering using JavaScript. You can, and this is one key of why JavaScript became really popular, and that is that you can load stuff into the browser without refreshing the page. And this was a big thing when it was discovered, I should say, because it was in the browser for a long time, but it was first discovered like in 2005, 2006. And when we came to the point where we could load stuff in the background, the web became more interesting. We could write better applications. And today, I would say that the web is becoming the platform for applications, or one platform for applications. It might not be the ultimate platform for applications. We are seeing that Android and iOS are popular in having native applications. But many of the native applications running on Android and iOS are basically web applications, just put in a box to run on the handheld device. So the web applications or this way of writing applications is gaining ground all the time. And we have this Electron. I talked to someone about Electron during the examination, and Electron is it's a way of running JavaScript applications in your desktop computer. And Slack, the new version of Slack, is using Electron, and Atom, the editor from GitHub, is using Electron, and actually the new version of Visual Studio from Microsoft is written in Electron, or using Electron as its container. But I think that the web as a platform will be really, really important in the long run as well. There is nothing saying anything else, I guess. So it's a good thing that you are focusing right now on the web, web, because you will always have use of those knowledges. Okay, I've dwelled on about this as well, the separation of concerns. So in this course, we are supposed to separate stuff into structure, presentation, and behavior, and I've said it before. So we shouldn't mix and add CSS into our HTML files. We shouldn't add JavaScript in our HTML files, and so on. And this is one way of looking at it. I think MPJ has a video on just on this topic of separation of concerns, that where he says basically that this way of looking at it is like sorting Lego in colors. It's a way of sorting stuff, but it might not be the best way. Maybe it's a better way to sort stuff in like wheels and different sizes and stuff, because you will have more use of that in the later run. However, when starting off with a web, I think this is really important to be able to separate those things, to separate JavaScript into one file or many files, separate the HTML and separate the CSS, because it makes you see the different, see those layers as layers, and see what is behavior and what is presentation, and argue about what should be presentation and what should be behavior. So in this course, we will be really, really strict on dividing stuff into HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. I'm not saying that if you start using like Angular or some other framework, that this is the best model. Maybe it's better to structure stuff according to what they do. Like, okay, we have some kind of widget on the page. Maybe we should add all the code for the widget together, not just separate it into HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And that's totally fine. But for this course, we will focus on this separation. And yeah. So when starting to write code, if you're used to, I haven't written programs for desktop computers in many years, but you have. But when you write a application for Windows, for instance, that application will get a lot of writes in the operating system. It will get the possibility to write files, read files, use the webcam, turn on the microphone, and so on. If we would have the same environment on the web, we will have a problem. So imagine yourself just browsing a web page and the webcam just turns on because the web page wanted to see how you look. Or the microphone secretly just turns on in the background. That would be quite creepy. Or if you take up your mobile phone and you surf to a page and the page instantly knows where you're at, located, down to a meter that would also be a problem. You don't want that. So the browser has a lot of security restrictions built in. It's quite a lot like the mobile or smartphone restrictions. So if you install an application on, and help me if I'm wrong, but if you install an application on an Android device, you will be presented with a list of, okay, this application wants the rights to do this, 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 and that. And if you do the same on the iPhone, you will get as soon as the application will try to use your camera, you will get a prompt that, okay, this application wants to use your camera. Is it okay to use the camera? And you have to confirm it as a user. And the browser works in the same way. So when you try to use, as developer, when you try to use an API, you want to know, you want to get access to the webcam. Then the browser will ask the user, okay, the application wants the webcam, is it okay? The user can say yes or no. And as a developer, you need to handle that as well. You need to be prepared that, okay, maybe not all users will want to share the webcam, and how will we handle that? Maybe the user don't want to share where the user is, or maybe the user don't want to give access to the address book, for instance. So those APIs are always, those APIs are not always available. And we are getting a lot of APIs in the browser now. As I said, the browser is becoming the platform. And by that, a lot of APIs are added. And they are added in a more rapid pace than ever. So we are getting, I might have said it, but we are soon getting Bluetooth support in the browser so that you could, if you have a mobile web application, it could connect to a Bluetooth device nearby without the user having to pair it in the operating system. The browser will take care of the pairing. And all of those APIs are always seen in the light of security. How and what could be default on, and what do we need to bother the user to ask for? So we have this sandbox. The browser is like a sandbox, and JavaScript cannot, for instance, read from the local file system. There might be an API some in the near future that will allow the browser to read from the operating system, but that API will be probably quite restricted. You are not allowed to communicate with third-party servers. So if you write a web application, you cannot just send a message to a random server and expect to get a result back. That server might say that, uh-oh, I'm not supposed to communicate with this application, so I won't. This was a problem some years ago where you had to do a workaround, but today we have something called cross-region resource sharing that allows the server owner to say that it's okay for all web applications to communicate with me. Yeah, that's a server restriction. It's not in the browser. And I guess it has something to do with like DOS attacks and stuff that if users just going into, say, if someone injects code on google.com and this code just issues a lot of responses against different servers, it could be a problem, and there could be other security problems with that as well. We will have a look at this when we start using WebSockets and Ajax. And this is just to show you an example of what you can be troubled with. So this is a pretty simple task for JavaScript. Okay, we want to find out the color of a link. So we have on our web page, we have an A element with some text. And we need to find out the color of this element. Seems like a pretty straight up easy question to do using JavaScript. It's just a couple of lines of code. Turns out this won't work. You won't get the correct color of the link. Any ideas why? Yeah, exactly. So if this link was visited before, it will probably be purple. And if the JavaScript could find out if a link is purple, then that JavaScript could find out which pages this user has been visiting. So what we could do then is to just generate a lot of A elements on our page, not visible for the user, and find out what color those links were supposed to have, and find out which pages the user has visited and which page it has not visited. This worked like in 2004. You could do this, and people did. So they shut down this possibility to find out the color. But this is just an example of stuff you will run into that, oh, why isn't this working? Always have in mind that, okay, you're running in the browser. There could be security restrictions to why this is not working. And this is one example. Okay, so JavaScript in the browser. We will start off by, and I will take this slide and then we'll take a short break. So now when we start writing JavaScript in the browser, we will write the JavaScript just as we did last week in a file, in a JS file, like you write the CSS in a CSS file. We place it together with the web application in the same folder as the index file, or preferably in a folder named JS or JavaScript. And we place the file in there. And then we need to link them together, right? Just like we do with CSS. We link the CSS file to the HTML file, and we need to do the same with the JavaScript. And we do that by using the script tag. And the script tag has an attribute source that points to the JavaScript file we want to load. In this case, we want to load the file build.js that is located in the JavaScript folder. And then we need to close the script tag. We need this closing tag as well. And that's it. When we've done this, they are connected. And the JavaScript inside of build.js will run. When it will run and how it will run and when it will load is quite complicated. I will show an image of that soon. But notice that wouldn't it be more like beautiful to put this in the head, just like we do with the CSS files? And they are supposed actually to be put in the head. But there is a problem with putting the JavaScript file in the head. And that is, if we just put it like this, what will happen is that the HTML parser will start at the top. And when it finds this script file, it will stop and it will freeze the rendering of the page. It will call out for this build.js, will contact the server, ask for the build.js. It will receive the build.js, and it will parse the build.js and run it if it's runnable code. If it's just functions without the function call, it will just notice that, okay, here are those functions. But if you have a call in the end running one function, the JavaScript will start running. And when it's finished running, then the page will continue rendering the page. So if you have a big JavaScript file that actually takes some time to run the program as well, then the user will just stare at the white page. And when the script is finished, the rest of the page will render. We don't want that. We want the user to be presented with something visually, and if this script takes like 200 milliseconds to run, it could be done while the user is just looking at the images and the headlines. That's why you basically always put scripts at the bottom. However, there is an however, and I will soon come to the however. But you will see this when you visit projects, when you add frameworks to your sites, you will always see the script tag in the bottom of the page. And that is because we don't want to interfere with the page rendering. We want to present something to the user before we start running our application. So as a rule of thumb, always put the script tag in the bottom. Okay, so this is the simplest way to connect JavaScript to our web pages. You could do it like this as well. You can write the script tags and just write JavaScript code inside of the script tags like this. Why shouldn't we do that? We are mixing stuff up again. We shouldn't write JavaScript right in our HTML files. And when I say you should not, there are always exceptions in some edge cases or in some frameworks or whatever. But for the sake of this course, you should not write JavaScript code in the HTML code. You should link in your JavaScript. You can also actually execute JavaScript right on tags. We shouldn't go into that for instance on an A tag, or A element, but we shall not do that. Okay, back to the loading of JavaScript. So if we just use the script tag like this, when the green one is the browser engine rendering the page, the blue one is loading of JavaScript, and the red one is executing of JavaScript. So if we just add a script tag somewhere on our page, the rendering will stop, we will load the file, and then we will execute it. And this gap will be problematic for the user because the page will freeze, basically. And if it's 2 milliseconds, maybe the user won't notice, but if it's 200 milliseconds, it will be quite laggy experience for the user. In later versions of browsers, they support the async attribute and the defer attribute on the script tag. And if we add the async attribute to the script tag, the loading will be asynchronous. So it will load the JavaScript in parallel with continuing rendering the page. But when the JavaScript is loaded and are supposed to be executed, the rendering of the page will stop. And that's because the JavaScript or the browser engine will not know if the JavaScript is altering anything in the page. So it needs to have the script run before it can continue. If you use the defer, the loading will be instantaneously asynchronous, but the script will run when the page has rendered the first time. So this is actually pretty good. If you like to put the scripts in the head portion of the page, you could and add the defer attribute. And then you will get a behavior like this. And that is probably the preferred behavior in many cases. But you need to have a look at compatibility with the older browsers if you do that. It's okay for this course. You can do whatever you like, but you should know why you do it. That's the important part. You can read more about, I borrowed this picture from that address, so you can read more about it there if you like. Okay, so the folder structure that we will use for this course will look something like this. The folder structures are, of course, up to every developer to choose for their self, or for every team of developers to choose. But we have chosen for you, so in this course you will use this structure. And the structure is like this. You will have a client folder, and client indicates that, okay, this is the client-side applications. You will also have a server folder, I think, in the exercise repo, And in some applications, maybe we are using the server folder. We need some kind of node application running. But you don't need to mind that. You can focus 100% on the client folder. And in the client folder, we've divided the application into three different folders: source, debug, and distribution, or dist. This is just because, okay, we want some kind of build step. We don't want our source code or source files to be exposed to the browser. We want to process them in some ways before we do that. For instance, maybe we don't have, maybe we want to minify stuff. Minifying is like removing all the comments, removing all extra tabs and spaces and spaces and returns and tabs and stuff, just to make the file size a little bit smaller. So, but we can't work like that. We can't work on like one line of code, and that would be stupid. So we need to work with comments and stuff. So in the source folder, we write our code to be easy for us as developers to read. But then we have a build step that takes this code, transforms it, and places it in the dist folder, the distribute folder. And when doing this, it will minify it. It will compress images, like you have the original images lying in the source folder, which are like 10 megabytes or 20 megabytes. But in the web applications, you want to compress those images down to like 200K or something. Then you could do that in the build step. So the dist is supposed to be the final distribution that will go to the web server and that users will use. However, in this course, we will focus on the source and the debug. And the debug is for you as a developer. When you make a change in the application, the build process will copy files into the debug folder, and it's the debug folder that you will look at in the browser. So, we will get back to this, I think. Yeah. But this is, have this structure at the top of your mind, because we will use this later on.
We
don't have the dist folder yet. No, I think we have just focused on source and debug. So the dist is actually just adding a couple of scripts. And when you, I will show it later, but when you run in Vagrant, when you do a npm run debug, what it says is, okay, watch the source folder and copy stuff to the debug folder. Then you should have an npm run dist that would do the same, but publishing it in the dist folder instead. And that is because this JavaScript files, for instance, will have a lot of extra information when we are in the debug mode that you don't want to distribute, because it will take up more or less double the space. So, okay, when we are in the browser, one thing to remember is that everything is global. Your code might not be the only code running in this environment at the same time. It might be a page where your code is running together with other developers' code. And we have a global object in the browser that is called the window object. And you can place stuff on the window object. And other developers, other scripts can use those methods or properties that you place on the window object. But that's not a good way of doing stuff, because this will only create problem for you. For instance, take this code. So say we have an app.js, and the only thing we do is putting everything like global in that file. And we do a let temp equals 22. We do a function called myFunction, and in the function, we forget to declare a variable called increaseTempBy and set it to 12. This, if it's a non-strict version of JavaScript, this will work. And then we take the temp and we add increaseBy temperature when we call this function. Stupid code, but forget that. So what happens now is that temp will be global. It's not attached to an object, so this one will be global. And that means if another developer executes a script in the same environment, they will also get hold of this temp variable. And we could have a look by doing a console.log window.temp. And if the window object is the global object, and if you do window.temp, it will show up. But more dangerously is this increased temp by. It's a local variable, right? It's created inside of the function. It should only live in this function. We have at least function scope in JavaScript. So if we are using let, we have the block scope. But if we are not using let, we have the function scope, right? Yeah, but here's a problem. This is not good, actually. So if you forget to write var or let or whatever before you declare a variable, that variable will be attached to the global object. So this is the same as writing window.increaseTempBy equals. So accidentally forgetting var will lead to that this variable will be placed on the window object. So if we write window.increaseTempBy, it will show 12. If you're using strict mode, use strict in top of your file, this will probably generate an error saying that you haven't declared a variable. So in strict mode, this is fixed, but it's not fixed if you're not using strict mode. So always declare your variables. But we can't work like this. We can't have a lot of global files that just talk to each other. We need some kind of modular system. And when we looked at Node the last couple of weeks ago, we had this require and exports that exports modules and encapsulates those modules. Well, we have that in Node, and it's called a Node node modules. They are part of Node. The browser isn't Node. It's using the V8 engine, but it's not Node. And it does not have the modules. So the browser environment today have no modules. So we can't put code in modules. And that's a big, big, big problem. And in ECMAScript 2015, maybe 16, this is solved with the introduction of modules. Not node modules, but another module handling, the V3C module handling stuff. However, I haven't tried this, but let's have a look. Can I use module? Okay. ECMAScript modules support okay, so we have it at the MDN, and the support is quite poor. Actually, if you're using Edge, they have in the build 14.3.4.2, they have implemented support for modules. So actually Microsoft is ahead in this one. But basically, there is no support yet. And that is, I think they are not convinced that about details in the modules, basically. So we don't have modules in the browser, but we want to use modules in the browser. So how do we do that? Well, we do it by using something called Browserify. There are different tools to do this. Browserify is one of them, but we will use Browserify. And what Browserify will do is it will watch your JavaScript files and look for keywords like exports or require. And when they find those modules, it will pack it together in self-invoking functions and stuff, and rebuild the file and place it in the debug folder or in the distribute folder or however you like to do it. So by using Browserify as a middleman, we can write modules the same way as in Node. And we will do that in this course. So for instance, we have the app.js. Note that it's in the source folder. So we require a statistics file that is down here that has exported an analyze function. And we require this one, and we run the analyze function, and we log this. This is quite the standard way of like having modules and using them. If we were to run this in Node, it will work out of the box. If we were to run this in the browser out of the box, it will crash and say that require is not a valid function. So what we do is we take those files, we take the app file, and we run it through Browserify. We have installed Browserify, and we do Browserify source.js app.js, and we pipe it to the dist javascript build.js. What Browserify will do is look in the app.js, find all dependencies, and go through those. So we only need to do it for the app file, for the starting file. And it will place this in the build.js. And it will work. You don't need to do this at the exercises or the assignment, because we have written scripts for you that do this. So when you boot up your Vagrant machine, that is a virtual machine running on your computer, and you log in and you do the command npm run debug, a lot of stuff will happen. We will start a web server, we will start watching the CSS files, and Browserify will start watching your source library. And when you add files to the source library, this will be automatically done. So it will watch those files and they will publish them in the build.js file. And if you go into the build.js, you will see a lot of parentheses and stuff going on. And that's just a way of packing this so that it don't interfere with the global scope. Because you don't ever want to publish anything on the global scope. Actually, there is a saying, if you publish anything on the global scope, Crockford will eat a kitten. And you don't want Crockford to eat kittens, so please don't publish stuff on the global scope. And that's a joke, of course. Okay. If we do this, we do it like with the intention of publishing this on the distribute folder. So this will be a distributable file to the browser. However, if we start to debug our JavaScript in the browser, this will be a problem because this build.js will not have anything, no resemblance with the original files. And if we find an error on row 3 in build.js, it can stem from like the statistics file, for all we know. So it will be really hard to debug your application if you do this. However, if you add the debug flag to Browserify, it will generate something called a source map. And the source map is just adding to the build.js a lot of code that will tell the browser from where this code stems, so that the browser could match the line numbers in your source folder with the line numbers in the code that is actually running in the browser. And to be able to debug our applications, we need to do this, because it will be horrific if we don't. So when you run npm run debug in the exercises, the debug flag will be added so that the source mapping will be done. However, the source mapping will double the file size of all the JavaScripts. So you don't want to do that when you distribute the application. But when you debug and run the application as a developer, you want to use the debug flag. So if we look in the browser down here, we will get a view something like this. We will see that we have JavaScripts. We will see that we have a client/source/js with the app and the statistics file. And we can go into those and stop the debugger and do whatever we like. But we also have the build.js, and the build.js is the file running, but this is ghost rendered for us to be able to debug the application. I will show this in a little while. Maybe quite soon. Yeah, I will show it now, I think. So, we have some developer tools in the browser, and it's those I want to show off. Back in the days, the developer tools were really, really poor in the browsers, especially in early versions of Internet Explorer. They were more or less not existing. But when Firefox was released, some developers made really, really good tools for Firefox for debugging web applications and working with web applications. And it was called Firebug. And Firebug was more or less the standard. Everybody used Firebug. And of course, the other browser manufacturers also looked at Firebug and implemented a lot of those features into the browsers. So in the browsers today, the developer tools are really well built. If you're using Chrome or Firefox or Edge, you have really, really, or Safari, you have really good developer tools built into the browser. They are so good that you could actually do everything in the browser. You could set up the developer tools to be the IDE, if you like, so you can edit everything, the JavaScript, everything inside of the browser, and save it in the local file system if you don't want to use WebStorm or Atom or Sublime or any other editor. And they are really good when it comes to stuff like profiling. If you want to run your application and find all those weak spots where the application is running slow or where it eats memory or whatever, they have really built-in support for that as well. Of course, if you're using Chrome, you will find some tools, and in Firefox, you will find another set of tools. Some prefer the Firefox one, some prefer Edge, some prefer Chrome, so that's up to you. They are kind of the same, but vastly different in other ways. So I will probably be using Chrome because I've gotten used to it. I used Firefox before. Some reasons I just started using Chrome, so I do that now. You are free to use whatever browser you like. Those are some of the stuff you can do, but basically watching network traffic is really, really important when it comes to that we are going to start to communicate with servers. It's important that you can look what's going on under the hood, what calls are being made, and what responses are you getting back. You can do stuff like throttling. If you sit and develop on your local machine, you have a fast local machine, you don't have any network traffic at all. You're using local host, so you're just piping it through the network layer on the computer. It's never goes on the internet, and your application will be super fast, and you will be so pleased. And then you publish it on Amazon or wherever, and users start coming in, and they think your application is slow, because you haven't tested it in a real environment. So if you like, you can throttle the network in the browser so that you can simulate that you are on a 3G connection or a slow internet connection, and the network layer will emulate that everything takes time, so you can get a feel of how the page feels for users with a mobile connection, for instance. You can debug JavaScript, and this is an important part. When I wrote code 2 weeks ago, I run the code in Node, and I could have WebStorm debugging the code as well, just like a normal debugger in Java or whatever, just to debug the code. However, right now we are just using the IDE as an editor, editing the files. When we save the file, the build process will go in, and this will be published on the web server. And in the browser, you visit the page and you watch your result. Then we want to we want to debug in the browser, not just the JavaScript code. We want to debug the code in the environment it runs. So you have two options. You can use the built-in debugger in the web browser. I tend to do that because it's the simplest way of doing it. And I mean, if you want to, you can start up Internet Explorer and debug the application in Internet Explorer without any hassle. You can, however, set it up so that you can, inside of your IDE, debug it using the browser. But it's a hazard to set up. I've tried, but I didn't get it to work properly. But you could if you like. But it's important that you debug your code. So if you, we hate the question, oh, it's just not working. Okay, what is not working? I don't know, it's not working. So you need to try to find somewhere where the problem is. And debugging is a great tool for that. I will show that in a moment. And of course, we have a console. And as I showed last week, Node have a console. You just write commands and you can write console.log and you will write echo those results to the console. And we have a console in the browser as well. So let's have a look. So this is Chrome. And we have this inspect. This is in Swedish, but it's inspect in English. And we'll look something like this. So I'm inspecting this presentation right now. So of course, if you're using, as I showed, if you're writing HTML and CSS, you have those tools. You could find this element. You can do changes on the element in real time. You can have a look at, okay, what happens if I get rid of the margin? Okay, that's that. If we change the color, what happens? And so on. So you have basic tools for doing HTML and CSS editing. However, we want to look at the JavaScript side of stuff. So we have the console. So you can open the console, and here you will get information about stuff happening or errors or whatever. In this case, it says fail to load a resource. Paper.css. So why is it looking in there? It shouldn't. Okay, so some reference is wrong to a CSS file. Probably has something to do with a CSS file for print or something like that. So you will catch those types of errors in the console as well, together with the JavaScript errors. And in this console, we could start, this is the simplest way of start using JavaScript. It's just writing code in this console and you will get a result. Let A equals 10, console.log A, 10. So, you could write code in here if you like. If you just want to try stuff out on other pages, you can write code in the console. This is not the practical way of doing it, but it's if you just need to try some JavaScript, you could do it like this. But we can write to this console, and there are several ways you can write to the console. You can echo out error. I think it's console.error. You will get something like this with a red label and stuff, and you can have warnings and information, and you can style stuff basically in the console. I tend to use console.log, but you could do console.error if something goes wrong. If something goes wrong, you probably would like to have some kind of error reporting system built in, but for this course, the console is just fine. Under sources, we will find all resources loaded, like CSS and JavaScript. So if we refresh the page here and have a look. So this is read from the local host right now. And we can see that, we have stuff loaded, like the reveal.js, and we could open up the file. This is not good that I'm running this locally. Let's make it more realistic. Let's do like you are supposed to do. So I have 15 minutes. So I will... Hello. Where is it? Maybe now. Yep. So I have a terminal. I have my example library. Think of it as your exercise library. If I look in it, I have the Vagrant file. I have some scripts and stuff. And in the if I enter the example folder, we have the client and the server. If I go into the client, whoops, we have the debug, source, and test. We have no dist in this case. If I go into the source, we have some index and JavaScript files and stuff. But let's, where are we? Let's start the Vagrant machine, because the Vagrant machine is the machine that holds all the Browserify, all the build process tools that I don't want to install on my local computer. And that's why I have Vagrant. You don't need Vagrant. You could install everything in your computer and run it. But when you tend to jump between projects, it's really good to have Vagrant, because you can just shut down one with Vagrant machine and start up another one, and you have a completely different environment. If you should start managing versions on your local machine, it will be a hazard quite quickly. So I do a Vagrant up. Fortunately, I've already done this, so it's just sleeping now. So it will be quite quick to start it up. If this is the first time, it will have to install the machine and all dependencies. Hello. Come on. Yeah, so it's up. To get in, I mean, I'm still in my local machine. To get into the Vagrant machine, I do a Vagrant SSH. And this will start up an SSH session to this machine. And it will try to get into the exercise library. But I don't have an exercise library, so I need to do this manually. Vagrant examples, minus call. So, pull. So this folder is the same as if I open a new terminal window, Java's client side. I've placed it in a, no. I placed it in this lectures repo, so that's why. Lectures 01 browser, example. Example. So this folder right here with the client and the server on my local machine is the same folder that I have in Vagrant / example inside the Vagrant machine. So those are the same files. And that means that I could do something like this. I could start my editor. Wrong window. I could start my editor and have all of those files available, edit them, and it's the same files that are edited inside of the Vagrant machine. So, let's go back. This is the Vagrant machine. So, to be able to watch those files change, I run npm run debug. And it will start web server running at, oops, disappeared, running at port 3000, like you see here. And that means that, okay, so this Vagrant machine has started a web server on the port 3000 on my machine, or in the Vagrant machine, but it's forwarded so I could get hold of that port inside of the browser. So if I write localhost colon 3000, I will get to that web server. And let's see. Could we have this one there and this one here? Could, yeah. So if I change something in the HTML file now, like that, save, you see that this triggers a rebuild of the HTML, and it copies those changes into the debug folder. So if I go into the browser and I do inspect, and I look at the sources, you will see that under JavaScript, I have the build.js. So this is the built JavaScript file. Have a look at it now, and it looks something like this. So this is an example I will show in the afternoon, but I haven't written this. This stuff up here, that's not mine. I've written a class with the name something, and I've created an instance of that class, but I haven't done this, and I have definitely not written this source mapping. So if we have a look in the JavaScript file, it looks like this. It's just a class something and new something, but Browserify has padded this with functions and put it in the build.js. We should not look in this file. However, because we have this source mapping, we have a folder called example client source.js with the app.js, and this is actually our file, which the browser like ghost renders. We see that everything is italic, and that's an indication that the files are really not there, but we can watch them anyway. And now I can do stuff like setting the debugger to this line, so when I do something, the debugger will stop, and we could have a look and inspect the code. It's quite hard to see, but you have like a normal debugger with watches and everything you need, and you can step and you can step into, and you know the drill. So make sure that the build process is running and that you can see those files that you are actually writing your code in. A neat little trick, if I refresh the browser, so the application is running and you're coding in your editor, and you want to see, okay, when the constructor runs, I want to stop the debugger. Instead of going into the browser and looking up which line this is, you could just write debugger like that. Refresh the page, and the browser will trigger on that keyword and stop the debugger in the spot. So that's quite handy if when you do debugging. Okay, I think you can find out more about the debugger by yourself. We need to remove that one. And you see, it's quite quick. I mean, I save and I refresh and it's already on place, but it could be like half a second delay sometimes. So be aware of that. But you see that, I mean, I change and I save and now it's done. So it's quite quick. More, we have looked at this one. If I reload the page, we can see the network traffic under the network tab. And here you can do the throttling thing. So if you like, you can set the page to a GPRS page, reload it. This is a really simple page, so it will load quickly. But we can see what happens if we go offline, for instance. Okay, we will get a dinosaur. And this is important when it comes to writing offline applications. We will have a look at that in the end of the course. That, okay, if you're writing applications, you want them to work offline. So if the user, Spotify for instance, if you're running Spotify in a browser and you lose network connection, it wouldn't be so nice if the music stopped playing and everything froze. It would be better if some of the playlist maybe was cached, like offline cached or something, and you can still play those playlists. And we will have a look at that. But you could simulate that you are offline without having to plug out the core. No throttling. Don't forget that one. It's not that nice if you do. You can disable the cache, and I recommend you all to disable cache when you're developing so that everything is loaded with every call. Unless you're trying out cache, then you could add the cache, because if stuff get cached and you're not, you don't want them to get cached, this will be a problem. So click in that to disable the cache. Just a short, you have the timeline, you could do recordings. So you can start a recording and you could like use your application, click around and do stuff, and then you stop the recording and you can have like a chart showing what took what time, what happened in the background. The profiling is somewhere similar if you want to. Yeah, you can record a JavaScript CPU profile to make sure that you're not hugging the CPU with your code. So you let other applications use the CPU as well. You can probably look at memory and other things in here as well. Under application, you will find things like the storage, like the data storage that I said was a separate part of the browser. You can find it here and you can investigate the storage and see what storage has been issued for this domain. As you can see, we have WebSQL and IndexedDB as well. So those are databases in the browser. I haven't used them a lot. The one of them is going out of support. I think it's WebSQL, and that it is IndexedDB that are supposed to be the future of data storage in the browser. But this is for storing larger amount of data. In a smaller web applications, you are typically using the web storage. And we will look at service workers later on in the course as well. It's a new thing in the most modern browsers, a thing that is really important as well. You can do stuff like clear it, and yeah, you get the picture. This one I haven't looked at actually. Yeah, there are a lot of things you can do in the browser, but on the web page for the course. No. This one. To this lecture, I've added some resources. I have the Nordic.js talk about optimization in the JavaScript engine. We have the conference article that I showed in the beginning. But we have a talk about Chrome developer tools. This is wrongly formatted. But in this one, they demo some of the tools and how to use them in Chrome. I recommend looking at this because you will get a notion of what happens in the browser or what you can do with built-in tools. You also have a getting started guide with a Chrome console, if you like, to watch that. Now, with that said, after the lunch, we will start coding JavaScript in the browser. So this was an introduction to how to get everything set up. I know there is a problem with the assignment and the exercises, and I will address that tomorrow in a separate recording, so that the introduction video I recorded will work, basically, because it does not out of the box, because I don't have a README file in my exercise repo. Many of you did the examination, the oral hearing last week, and don't forget to focus on both the practical assignment and also read up on the theory in the book. On my lectures, I will not say everything. I will take the things that I think is most important and set them in a context for you. This afternoon, I will not go through each and every API method on the DOM, for instance. I will present the big picture, and you will have to read up in the literature on how to do each and every call. So don't forget to read up. This part, the client-side JavaScript, starts today, and it's 3 lectures. It's 2 today and 1 next week. And next week, on the afternoon next week, we will have our first peer instruction. And the peer instructions are on the peer instructions, it's really important that you get here and that you are participating in the peer instruction. It will help you with the questions for the oral hearing. So we will do questions in the same type of questions that will appear on the oral hearing, but we will do them together. You will have your laptop or a smartphone with you, so you will be able to vote anonymously on options. And if everybody gets a question, I will just skip to the next one. But if we find that, oh, there is a lot of wrong answers on this one, then we could have a discussion about that separate topic. So it's good for us to know where you are in the course, and it's good for you to know where you are in the course. So, and we will not stream the peer instruction. So this peer instruction will be in this classroom only. If some of you is not here or don't have the opportunity to go here, please mail me and I could do a recording, and you could take part of the recording afterwards, but it's quite boring to do it that way. So I recommend you to be here. The peer instructions have been really well received by students when we've done it. We've done it for the past year in Kalmar, and the students love it a lot because it's a great opportunity to know where you are in the course. So we have 2 peer instructions planned for this course, and they are the week before the exam, so that you will have additional time to prepare to the exam. Okay, any questions about the fluffiness of the course, stuff surrounding not just JavaScript, but anything else? I know that it's a lot of tools for the first exercise, and web development is a lot of tools. There is no getting around it. You could like do HTML in an HTML file and a CSS file and publish it on an old web server or something like that, but that's not how anyone do stuff anymore. So we are trying to incorporate modern tools into the course, and with that comes some kind of threshold that you need to get over to be able to grasp all those tools. We are trying to get it as convenient as possible by the Vagrant machine, but the Vagrant machine itself is a tool. So you have to believe me when I say that, okay, you have another tool, but that tool will probably replace 10 other tools. So by using Vagrant, you don't need to think about those 10 other tools. You could think about those 10 other tools and omit Vagrant or Docker, but then you need to learn a lot of other tools. So yeah, you could do it any way you like, but we prefer to use Vagrant or maybe Docker in the years to come. But for now on, we go with Docker, Vagrant. Whoa, okay, lunch. I'll be here after lunch as well, and we will have a look at the DOM and the events. Okay. Thanks.